Right, welcome to chapter 19, Optical Instruments. In today's lecture, we're going to cover the first part of the chapter and just discuss how all of these lens things apply to the real world. So this is going to be 19.1 to 19.4. And we will talk about cameras, eyes, magnifying lenses, microscopes, and telescopes. And in the notes on D2L, you'll see that you've got a section for each of these, as well as a little bit of a review for the thin lens equation and magnification equation, as well as when to use positive and negative values for the S, S prime, F focal length, and M magnification variables. And so before we even jump in, I'd like you to just take a second and review those. Put down what you know from memory or check in your book from chapter 18 to get the beginning of those notes. All right, we do have the magnification equation here, as well as the thin lens equation. And we didn't focus too heavily on it, but this time I'm going to tell you that a negative M value means that I've got an inverted image, while a positive M value means that I've got an upright image. And so negative M means that the object is this way, but the image is that way. And then a positive M means that they're both facing in the same direction. We then have the thin lens equation, which you're familiar with, but we'll continue to apply these today. Again, please take a second to review when things like S prime are negative and when F is negative. It's devils in the details in these problems. All right, so I'm going to start off with a pinhole camera. And when we first came around to making cameras and film, this is initially what we had. And you can make one at home. All you need is a light-proof box. And so even though we drew this clear, it needs to be something opaque, something that light can't get into. And you simply poke a really small hole in the front of that. Back in the day, what we would do is place these silver chloride plates on the back. Silver chloride reacts with light. And so we would have a little screen here that would cover up the pinhole. We would arrange the photo that we wanted to take and slip up this little cover for the pinhole. Light would come back and kind of burn or react with the silver chloride paneling on the back, and we would get a picture. Now, these pictures weren't great, and they were kind of blurry, but a picture nonetheless. And so this uses just a pinhole, and the rays come in, and we get an inverted and smaller image. Right, and so upside down. Modern cameras have a notably improved thing here, and instead of a pinhole, modern cameras actually use a converging lens. And so if we're looking at that from the side, remember that's the one that looks like a football. A converging lens takes all of these rays from whatever object we're trying to film and essentially does the same thing as a pinhole, but it focuses it a lot better than a pinhole. And so we get nice clear images. And we still have, you know, now not these heavy plates, but film that reacts with that light. Same thing on a normal camera. There is a shutter, which is that opaque boundary. As soon as you press the, yep, I'm ready to take a picture, it lifts up the shutter and burns the image on the film, right? Essentially, this is just what you've been doing. With a ray tracing diagram. And so typically our converging lenses have a small focal length. Whatever we're trying to take a picture of is outside of that focal length, and it converges the rays into a real and inverted image. The way a camera focuses an image then, at least the old school ones, is they would kind of move this film back and forth until it found the focused place, right? Some cameras opt to have the lens move back and forth to focus it on the film. That's definitely the more common version. But just like your lab last week, you know, if you have to adjust the screen to get a just right focused image, and cameras do the same thing. A digital camera has a really interesting thing. Instead of film, it has a receiver that is called a CCD. And that stands for a charged coupling device. A charged coupling device, all it does is take those rays from the lens and focuses them in onto this charged coupling device, where it has sensors to tell us about the intensity of a color that's being received. When we do our light mixing lab, this will make a little more sense. But for instance, in this picture, this is receiving high values of orange and yellow and red light, where this is receiving high values of green light, not so much red. And so digital cameras take it a step further, make it a little bit smarter, and kind of interpret the wavelength and the color as well, instead of just depending on a reaction for that. As we focus the camera, again, we move the lens towards and away from the film to find a place where S prime is nice and focused. For this, we still use the thin lens equation, and we still use the magnification equation. And so S prime is just the location, right, on the film, how far that is from the lens. So this is S prime, where that is focused. And then S is still the distance from the subject to the lens. Focal length depends on the camera, right, on the lens that you're using. And so moving on to eyes, because eyes are kind of like cameras, in your eye, you have all of these tiny little muscle fibers that expand and contract your pupil, which is kind of like your camera pinhole, right, or camera lens. And you've also got a converging lens in here. And so these muscles expand and contract to actually change the shape of that lens and change the focal length of that lens depending on what you're trying to look at. And so if you're trying to look at something very, very far away, your eyes are relaxed and your lens is kind of flat, right? There's not a whole lot of curvature to it because you're looking at something far away. If you flatten out a lens, it doesn't refract as much or as greatly, and it focuses on the back of your eyeball to have, again, that real and inverted image. However, if you, say, hold your hand really close to your face, those muscles in your eye contract and kind of squish the lens in your eye to give it a greater curvature, and that allows you to focus things in closer. We see this trend as well with microscopes, and so the first microscopes had these extremely curved lenses to try and refract powerfully so that we could see really small stuff. So greater curvature means being able to see closer. Okay. Your eyes kind of relaxing and contracting and changing the lens in your eye, that whole process of just focusing is called accommodation. Your far point, the farthest point at which you can focus things, should be infinity, right? For healthy eyes, it is. And your near point should be around 25. And so your near point is something that you can pause the video and find for yourself. Basically, you can take anything that you can focus on. Text is really good. And close one eye and slowly, gradually bring that text closer and closer to your face until it's just barely out of focus, and then back it up until it is. And that place that is nearest your eye at which you can focus is called your near point. Now, for normal, healthy vision, this is about 25 centimeters. For kids, it's a lot less. Kids can see much, much closer. But then as we get older and our eyes do this accommodation, they expand and contract and expand and contract, those little tendons and muscles in your eye actually wear out. And what we see is that your near point, as you get older, gets farther and farther as those muscles lose flexibility with age. And this is a condition called presbyopia. It happens to most people, right? Your eyes work very hard throughout your life, and they wear out. And so I always give my parents a really hard time about having to hold out their, like, birthday and Christmas cards, you know, all the way out at their arm's length, because their near point, well, because of presbyopia, has increased from the standard 25 centimeters to probably like 50 centimeters, right? And at this point, you either need longer arms or reading glasses. Okay. We talk about refractive disorders as being nearsightedness or farsightedness. And I'm going to give you a couple of words that I want you to associate with the two of those. So a normal eye and a healthy eye that doesn't need glasses. The eye is perfectly shaped, right? And the lens is able to extract and expand and accommodate to perfectly focus, just like a camera, that real inverted image from the incoming light. A nearsighted eye is actually a little bit too long in its curvature. And so light is technically focused here, but well, that's not where your receiving cells are. And so by the time that light gets back here, you get a blurry image. Nearsighted people can see things very close up, but not far away. We associate this with a condition called myopia. And so I want you to know that nearsightedness is myopia. Conversely, farsightedness, the eye is a little too squished. It's right. And so here's the focused image way back here. But again, what you receive is a blurry image. The eye is too short. Farsighted people can see far away, but not close up. And then the medical term for this is hyperopia. So hyperopia is corrected with a converging lens. Myopia is corrected with a diverging lens. And to give you an idea, myopia, again, nearsightedness, you can see things near, but the faraway stuff is blurry, right? And then hyperopia, farsightedness, you can see things far away, but not close up. And so with these refractive disorders, you usually have to go to an optometrist, and they will prescribe you a lens which will adjust that focal point in conjunction with your eye to give you a focused image. So we're going to talk real fast. This is an equation for eyes, and this is the refractive power formula, if you're following along. So this P stands for refractive power. F is still the focal length, and remember, make sure that if you're using a diverging lens or a converging lens, you're adjusting the sign of the focal point as needed, right? And so the refractive power is just this inverse of the focal length. And that's handy because, well, that's what we calculate in the thin lens equation. So you don't have to multiply out to find the focal length. Well, you've already got the refractive power, which is what your doctor gives you. So pre-biopia, hyperopia, and myopia are all called refractive disorders. These are just as a simple thing of saying you need glasses or you need contacts to fix this. When a doctor writes a prescription, it's an order of refractive power. And a doctor will usually write a prescription for each eye. And if you like close your right eye and open your left, and then do the opposite, close your left and open your right, usually one eye sees a little bit closer than the other. And so this is why you have a prescription for each eye. This is measured in diopters. And so when a doctor writes a prescription, like a plus 2.5, that's your left eye, and then a plus 2.0, well, that would be your right eye. And that's this idea of diopters, of what you need. And that plus would indicate that I need a converging lens, something with a positive focal point. Right. So suppose somebody has a near point of 100 centimeters. What prescription do they need for a correction? So their near point is 100, but we need a near point of about 25. Let me erase this. So their near point is 100, but we want to focus that at a near point of 25. And so what we do is we say, okay, well, they've got, we want to put the image at an S of 25 centimeters and S prime at a negative 100. And so we're going to take something that's actually at 25 centimeters and we're going to use a lens to form an image that's out at S prime at negative 100, right? And so for their eye, if we're looking like this, we're going to take something that's close that they can't normally see and we're going to focus it way outside at negative 100, and okay, well, what's their prescription? So at that point, it's just a plug and chug. So I do 1 over 25, or 0.25 for me, because I like to convert back to meters, plus 1 over negative 1 is equal to 1 over the focal length. And remember, this is just the prescription in diopter, so I don't need to find the focal length. And so 1 over 0.25 is 4. And I'm going to do my work over here. So 4 plus negative 1 is equal to my prescription, and 4 plus negative 1 is 3. So this person needs a positive 3 diopter prescription. Right. Really fast, and I'm just going to go through this because, well, we're talking about eyes, and that's important. Cataracts is when a cloud or cloudiness forms in your lens due to aging, and this is just like if you leave something out in the sunshine, sometimes it will cloud up, and so your lenses are the same. Cataracts can kind of blur images as well. And then I always have students ask about eye shine, right? And so eye shine, your lens kind of forms an image, and this is all extracurricular to physics. Most animals have this little membrane in the back of their eye called the tapetum mesitium. And depending on the animal, that's different colors. And so, like down here, I've got a cow's eye, and you can see at point B is their blue tapetum mesitium. And so at night, when light comes in to their fully expanded pupil, a lot of it gets reflected right back out, and it reflects off of that tapetum mesitium, and you see a blue color from the inside, right? And so for humans, this is kind of what's responsible for red eyes. I would say go ahead and try number 9 and 11, which is part of your homework. But if you want to just keep going on with the lecture, then you can do that too. So I'm going to move on to magnification. And magnification can give us some pretty cool and funky images, as well as be incredibly useful in our daily lives. Here, what we see is that we've created this illusion of people being far away, or people being very small, sorry. And so we know just from common life experiences that this guy is actually the same size as all of these people, but because he is closer to us, our brain appears or interprets that as bigger than things that are far away, right? And so there are these two ideas of apparent size and angular size. And that last picture is a really good example of apparent size. If something, even if it's smaller, is closer, right? We interpret that to be larger. There's also angular size, where we take two objects of the same height, right, like the people, and if we put one closer, the angle at which these rays come into our eyes actually produces a larger image, right, then the smaller angle will produce that little smaller image on our eye, and so we interpret this as big, right, and because of the small angle, we interpret this as small, even though in actuality these two things are the same size. We can also make some pretty funny images by taking things of different size sizes and making them the same angular size. So down here, if I took, like, people do this with the Leaning Tower of Pisa a lot, right? And so they stand in front. They're a tiny object compared to the Leaning Tower. So they stand in front, and then they pretend to knock over the Leaning Tower of Pisa. But because they're the same angular size, our eye kind of interprets them as, oh, okay, well, red object is the same size as green object, which is an untrue statement, but it makes for funny pictures. Okay. This is the magnifying formula, and so magnifiers actually use angular magnification, that the theta of the angle over the initial angle, well, long story short, what we can get is a magnification of this ideal near point divided by the focal length of a magnifier. In order to make a magnifying lens work, you have to hold it so that whatever you're trying to view, so if it's like text in a book, is right about or at exactly the same place as the focal length of that lens. And so magnifying glasses only work if you're holding this at a distance to the object where the focal length and the object are about the same distance out from the lens. What they do then, all right, and so this is a converging lens with an object inside the focal point. As we are looking through the lens, what we're actually seeing is this magnified and upright virtual image that is kind of beyond that. And so what we see is bigger, right? We don't see this actual what's actually there. And again, these only work if the object you're looking at is at almost exactly the focal length of that. Really, really good magnifying glasses can get up to 20 times magnification. Most of them, though, fall between 5 and 10. And this is an absolute value, or I'm sorry, this is a unitless number, because what you're going to get is centimeters over centimeters, and those will cancel. So magnification doesn't have a unit. We just say like 5x or 10x, right? And that's the number that goes there. For microscopes, we use lenses in conjunction with one another. And so in microscopes, and specifically compound microscopes, we have lenses down here of different curvatures. And because they have different curvatures, they also have different magnifications. So we might have like a 10x lens, but then there's another lens up here that could also have some magnification to it, so like 10x, right? And to find the magnification of a microscope, I take the magnification of the what we call objective. So this is the objective. And I multiply it by the magnification of the eyepiece. And so the magnification of a scope is equal to the magnification of the eyepiece multiplied by the magnification of the objective. And so, like for this one, if I've got a 10x objective and a 10x eyepiece, then I'm going to get a total magnification of 100x, right? We're going to play with some microscopes in class so that you can work on playing with this. I'm going to move on to the next slide and talk about some variables for microscopes and kind of the microscope formulas to figure out, well, how big is that? In a regular microscope, there's a prism here that bends this light. But it's easiest to draw a microscope as just this one big straight tube with two lenses. And so that's how I'm going to draw it, right? I'm going to pretend that that's not there and we've just got a big tube. So here we go. We've got the objective down here and the eyepiece over here. And what a microscope does is it takes these two lenses and uses images in conjunction with one another. I want you to take time in your notes to go ahead and draw this out and label the variables and go ahead and write your equations. So L is the length of the tube. The longer the tube is for a microscope, generally the more powerful that it is. For most biologic microscopes, L is going to be 16 centimeters. That's right where it falls. And then also, because we have two lenses, we've got two different focal lengths, and we denote that with subscripts. So F sub 0 up here is the focal length of the objective lens. And again, the objective is this guy, right? The one that's pointed at the specimen. So there's a focal length of the objective, and there's also a focal length of the eyepiece, which we denote as F sub E. For all of these microscopes, we use converging lenses, and so that's a standard thing. And then magnification, right? So the magnification of a scope, we can talk about S prime over S and the length over the focal length of the objective, right? And so when we talk about the magnification of the objective, there we go. We can find it pretty easily based on the focal length and the length of the tube. This is the magnification for the entire microscope. And I talked about on the last slide how that's equal to magnification of the objective over magnification of the eyepiece. The other way that we can write that in an equation form, because we don't always have it, sometimes we're given focal lengths, right? And so we'll do length of the tube divided by the focal length of the objective, multiplied by 25 over the focal length of the eyepiece, and then we'll take the inverse or the opposite, negative 1 times all of that to get the total magnification, right? And then last but not least, we're going to go on to telescopes. Again, I really suggest that you do the same thing here. I suggest that you go ahead and draw this picture to list out your variables and what they are, as well as this equation down here. Oh, there we go. So for telescopes, these have a longer focal length than microscopes, and we focus in objects at a distance. And so instead of the object being like right here by the lens, we're talking about like the moon or Jupiter. But generally they kind of work the same way. And so for objects coming in here, we consider these to be parallel rays, and they get refracted into the focal length of the objective. And you're going to notice that this is a lot longer. We get a real and an inverted image here. And we place the eyepiece such that this real and inverted image, these rays start to come through and they get refracted out perfectly to our eye and then refracted back in to give us the upside down image that our brain flips. Is that kind of confusing enough for you? The magnification of a telescope, is equal to the theta of the eyepiece over the theta of the objective. And there we go. Oop, eyepiece and objective. Usually pretty small, but the more common is to look at them in terms of focal length. And so we do magnification is equal to the opposite of the focal length of the objective over the focal length of the eyepiece, right? And for your homework, we've got these problems. So go ahead and start giving them a go. Do make sure that you've got your notes filled out, and I will see you in class.